I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. I was raised by the wolves. Eight to they fool. Run through the night, playing with your life. Going against the pack, that's risking your life.
All right, folks, we are back with another edition of the Red and White Podcast. I'm your host, Evan, here with my man, Zach. So you know what that means. We are going to talk basketball. What do you think about Turquavion coming back, Zach?
I made my thoughts known on that. I that's great. Great for NC State. That's all I can say. I know we've got him and Marcel. And that's about all I know about – and Breon Pass. And that's about all I know about the basketball team, man. I gave up on that. It's just brutal.
You're not alone there, buddy. It's going to be a whole new team next year. It'll be interesting to see what happens. But really, we want to talk about baseball. The Pack made it to the ACC Championship game. They lost. They are 0-7 versus Carolina in the ACC Tournament, 0-8 in ACC Championship games. Avent can't get over the hump. I think one of the most important games we've had in a long time. I mean, turned out to be even more so when they didn't get into the NCAA tournament. We'll get into that. But what was your feeling on their performance in the tournament? And then, we'll get into the championship game after that.
So, coming off of what they came off of the last couple of weeks of the season, the last month of the season, they never went out of the state of Carolina, played Carolina, Duke, and Wake Forest. I wasn't expecting them to make it to Saturday. I wasn't expecting them to win their pod, but they did. Played good ball, and exceeded my expectations based on kind of what had been put on the field throughout the season. That was a high point. Kind of getting into the – I think I said in the pod chat after Pitt had won their pod, I said, man, if State beats Miami tonight, we are sitting pretty looking, going into the weekend, 2 days rest. And I knew we would beat Pitt on Saturday. And after Carolina had beat Notre Dame earlier in the day on Saturday, I told Lauren, I was like, well, this is going to be destiny. Again, not to do the whole woe is me thing, but if you're not skeptical, when things work out this way and you don't have your guard up as a State fan by now, I don't know what to tell you. You're either a brand new State fan or you're just playing down on the ignorant, So,
it's interesting to me. It's twofold in that. It's not just that we were playing Carolina. It's just that Carolina was absolutely on fire at the end of the season. Playing well.
Did you see after they beat Clemson on night one? Did you see what I put in the pod chat?
Uh-uh.
I said, just telling y'all now, Carolina's going to win the tournament. Because, you and I have talked enough about baseball that I've talked to you. And last year when State got on that roll to end the year, when a team gets hot at the right time,
yeah,
that's a lot of it. And Carolina was hot coming in. And State got hot in the tournament. Carolina was hot coming into the tournament. And I said after they beat the brakes off of Clemson on the first night of the tournament, I said Carolina's going to win the tournament. And then Friday when they played Virginia Tech and blanked them 10-0?
Mm-hmm.
That's it. they were hot. They're the hot team right now.
It's interesting, man. Like they were, and then I put in the chat when we were talking about this that it didn't feel like a team of destiny to me when Villeman came in and pitched 4 2/3 scoreless inning or no hit innings, and to me it felt like we didn't show up more than Carolina was destined to win. Mm-hmm. That's kind of how I feel about that championship game. Overall, we didn't show up. That's what it comes down to. Like, I don't think it was anything that Carolina was doing better than us. I mean, they mm-hmm. were playing well, they were hot, but you know, you had a guy in Villeman who comes in and completely shuts them down. And this is the second championship game in a row where he has had a performance like that. You know, mm-hmm. if you combine those two games, last year and this year's championship game, he pitches a no-hitter against Duke and Carolina. Like,
yeah,
pretty good. But the bats didn't show up. The decision to start Whitaker, we could probably get into, you know. Mm-hmm. Let's do that. Let's start with that. Like, they put Whitaker in, who has, you know, didn't have a good outing against Carolina earlier in the year. And he just, you know, he hasn't had it all year. He's been scraping by, trying to get out of innings. You know, it was a weird move for me. Mm-hmm. I didn't think, if I'm Avent, I'm not starting Whitaker. Would you?
No. If, you know, obviously we're not in the dugout, we're not in the clubhouse. Whitaker definitely would have pitched, but if I was Avent and I knew coming into Sunday, okay, Willitson is available and he's available for 50 pitches or 75 pitches, or I'm gonna, you know, it's gonna be his call, or unless he gets in trouble, I would have started Willitson. If you knew he was available on Sunday, which obviously we did because he came in the second inning. But if you knew he was available on Sunday, I don't understand why you don't start him. You know, you give your – to me, you want to give your team a chance to get out front. And Willitson gives you – either Willitson or Villeman give you the best chance of that. So if you start Willitson – you know, you give your offense a chance to put up some runs while Willitson's doing what he normally does against Carolina. I think, you know, two of his better starts in his career have come against Carolina. And so I would have started him, hoped that he could have gotten me to the fourth inning, you know, give us a chance to get 3-4 runs on the board while keeping Carolina at bay. Then I would have probably gone to Whitaker for maybe the fifth and sixth inning. And then I would have gone to Villeman for the seventh, eighth, ninth. You know, I'd have tried to shorten the load as much as I could on Whitaker by sandwiching him between our two horses. Yeah. And, you know, you can't, I wouldn't have, I people say, you know, you should have started Villeman. Okay, fine. Let's say Villeman goes out there and gets hit pretty good. Now you're down to Willitson and Whitaker, and you got Willitson on a pitch count because of what he just did on Wednesday. You know, so I get wanting to save one of your horses till the end, but one of your horses is on a pitch count in Willitson. So I would have started Willitson, sandwiched, and followed that up with Whitaker, and then gone to Villeman. You know, and you could have had a very, very short leash with Whitaker in that situation, you know, and gone straight to Villeman. And Villeman could have been your – he could have gone, you know, Villeman could have gone the fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth. You know, and I think he ended up doing 4 2/3. So he came in the fourth with one out, you know, so, or in the fifth with one out.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's hindsight is always 20/20, but that would have been my philosophy in the situation is if you know your horse is available, ride him, you know, and go until Matt gets in trouble. Go until he comes in the dugout and says I'm done, and then you go to Whitaker, you know. And if Whitaker gets in trouble, then you go to Villeman.
So yeah, the fact that Wilson was available and didn't start, and they ended up putting him in, you know, after 1 1/3 from Whitaker, to mm-hmm. just to me that just seems like a lack of foresight, right? They just. Yeah. I would love to know what the thought process was behind it. And we haven't actually heard anything from the baseball team since that game, since they got snubbed. That's another thing. But I didn't like that move. And what I was saying with – and I was one of those guys that says, hey, start Villeman. Because if you're going to keep Willitson on a pitch count, you like go with your other horse, uh-huh. take the risk, lay it all on the line, put your best player on the mound. And even though he has been, you know, inconsistent this year, he's been good in clutch moments. He's been good in championship games. You know, he's been good in these kind of games. Uh-huh. And I equated to when the Arkansas Super Regional last year, when they played Gyro Ball Boy against us, Kevin Copps, right? He's their closer. He comes in. They know they have to win. They know they have to lay it all on the line. And then what they do, they give it to their best pitcher, even though he's a closer. He goes 8 innings. You know, we won 3-2. He pitched a magnificent game. And to me, that's what I'm doing. This game was a real chance for Avent to get over that hump and just do anything you can to get that win. And the outcome was still the same. I think that to me is probably the most disappointing part of it.
And another frustrating part of it is, you know, it ended up kind of working out the same way the Wednesday night game did. You know, Whitaker starting, Wilson coming in. And, you know, I think Whitaker can be really good, really effective. But it's tough that second, third time through the order on him. And you start to see that. And I think, you know, as he matures and as he grows, develops, you know, more depth on his pitches, maybe develops even, you know, another pitch into his repertoire, I think that'll help him. But Willitson and Villeman have the big game experience. And both of them were obviously available Sunday. So I'm not sure why you risk starting Whitaker, you know. But, you know.
What were you saying earlier in the week? And maybe it was after the Wednesday game it must have been the Wednesday game when they were up comfortably and still put Villeman in. And you were talking about his.
What I said was, I swear to God, if Chris Villeman even has a jersey on right now, I'm going to scissor kick somebody in the throat. Because, I mean, it was, you're up, what? We were up like 6 on pitch.
Yeah.
And I think somebody in the pod chat was at the game and was like, Villeman's in the pen getting loose. And I lost it. I'm like, we're up 6 in the 9th inning or 8, whatever inning it was. You know, to me, you don't bring in Villeman until the tying run is at the plate. So if you're up 6 and they load the bases, you still don't bring him in. If they hit a grand slam, you still don't bring him in. Now, if that next guy gets on base and the tying run is now at the plate because they've cut the lead to 2, you got a runner on, and the tying run is at the plate. Okay, then you go to Villa for him to shut it down. But there's no such thing in baseball as a 6-run home run or a 5-run home run. You know, so I didn't understand why we went to him. I don't know if that would have influenced Avent by not going to him on Saturday. I don't know if that means that he would have started on Sunday. You know, if we could have got out of Saturday without using him for those 20 to 30 pitches that he threw, you know, maybe he starts on Sunday and maybe you and I are sitting here having this, doing this pod chat, drinking whiskey. You know? But,
you know, it was, yeah, his life as a State fan. Like, and it's interesting though, that's just another one of those decisions that makes you question the whole thing, and I'll get where we're going with that later. But looking at the, you know, the macro of it, State's pitching, they've just under Chrysler, they just have not had it right. I just feel like we haven't had the depth. We've had a couple, you know, really good pitchers, but we just haven't had the overall depth you need to, you know, to win. And I didn't think this team was going to make a College World Series run. I thought they had a real chance because of the way they were playing in the ACC tournament. But they've got to do something to address the pitching woes. I feel like there's inconsistency in how they handle them, but it's also in, you know, the development and depth of the rotation.
To be completely honest, I mean, you're 100% right. Highfield going down really put a kink in the plans.
Right.
You know, I thought – in my mind, after Sunday's game, I said, if you make a super regional, it's a good year. You've had a good year after what all happened on Sunday. You know, our pitching just ran out. But even going back to, I mean, you're 100% spot on, because going back to last year, in all honesty, State had no business making the College World Series with having Johnston, Highfield, Willitson, Villeman, and Evan Justice. those were your five arms. And in a three-game series over the course of a weekend, over the course of a super regional, what have you, you know, the state had no business making it through the super regional. Omaha sets up a little better because you play one day, then you're off. Then you play, then you're off. So Omaha sets up a little bit better until the championship series. But in a super regional where you're going 3 days in a row, back to back to back, only having five arms, you know, against that caliber of competition, right, is very, very, very difficult. So, you know, state had five very good arms last year in the five that I just named, and they were able to, those guys were able to carry it and get us to where, you know, get state to the College World Series. This year when Highfield went down, that was, you know, that was kind of, that was the nail in the coffin as far as another Omaha run, because, you know, we've seen what happens on the Sunday games. Kanan goes out and he does what he does. And, you know, but on a Friday, our bullpen loses the game. On Sunday, our bullpen loses the game, you know, something like that. And so the pitching depth is really, really a concern. And there's a difference between, we've talked about it in football, we've talked about it in baseball, there's a difference between depth and quality depth. And the quality depth is just not there yet. Some of the guys are really young. You know, I know we had some injuries going on, and like I said, Highfield going down. But you know, you can't depend on your Friday, Saturday, Sunday starters to go out and give you seven innings. You know, each starter to give you seven innings, then go to Villeman in the eighth as your setup man, and then go to Justice in the ninth, like what we did, and what we did last year. That's not a sustainable way to go about things, in my opinion, because a lot of times your starter only gives you five, you know, and then you've got to piece together sixth, seventh, eighth, and ninth. And state was able to do that some last year, but it's not sustainable, in my opinion. You need more arms. You need more quality arms.
Yeah, that was my takeaway from that weekend, and that was what I had said.
And what gets me is, you know, you got Carolina, Miami, Wake Forest, they go to the bullpen and they're bringing in these guys that are, you know, in the fifth or sixth inning that are, you know, ripping 96, 97 mile an hour fastballs. You know, we don't have a guy on the team this year throwing that hard. You know, Villeman runs it up there in 94, you know, when he really reaches back and lets it rip. And Justice did it last year, but you know, we don't even have a guy on the team. We didn't have it last year either. But at some point, you know, you've got to recruit and retain some power arms more than just one guy. Yeah. You know, last year you had two. You had Justice and Villeman. But you know, it's to me we're lacking pitching depth in power arms and in the number of arms overall that are quality. And I'm not one of those guys that sits here and says just because you throw 97 doesn't mean you get hit, because any, you know, if you face 96, 97 and it's flat, it actually looks, I mean, a 96, 97 mile an hour fastball that is flat and doesn't move is easier to hit than like Highfield or Willetson's fastball that is 89, 90 with movement. A ball coming at 89 or 90 that has some tail or some run to it is harder to hit than a 96, 97, 98 mile an hour fastball that is flat. So, you know, it's not just, I'm not just that guy, oh, let's go out there and throw somebody that's going to overpower them, because that's not going to happen. Not at that level.
They got to hit the portal and they've got to recruit some pitchers. Like, I mean, mm-hmm. like you said, I think that they've got enough pieces coming back, supposedly, as of now, that should give this team a real chance to do well next year. But they have to shore up their rotation. They have to get some depth, and we are going to have to go to the portal for it. I think if they're going to capitalize on the talent in this team, you know, that's just the biggest hole. Again, seems like every year, kind of the same conversation.
Yeah, and see, I think you're losing Villeman this year. I think he's gone.
Yeah, you
know, I think he's gone. It would not surprise me for Willetson to go. I don't know how much more he could improve his stock. Pretty sure he's draft eligible this year. I think Highfield will be back just because of his injury. And so, you know, that's, if those two go, there's your two workhorses from this year.
I kind of look at the NIL deals and see if that is any indication on who's staying and who's going. Like Highfield just signed with the Pack of Wolves, probably means he's going to stick around. You know, his injury on top of that, you know, he's got a little bit more he can showcase, a little bit more he can develop to, you know, for the next level. I think Villeman's gone. I think he's lefty throwing, you know, 94, mid 90s. Somebody's going to take a chance on him. Somebody's going to give him a run. I feel like he's gone. Yeah. And then who knows with Wilson. Yeah. Interesting. Speaking of other players that are gone, I don't even know if we should get into that one yet. Let's go. I want to go back into the ACC championship game and just the overall state of the program. One of the pieces I wrote and probably put it out tomorrow is around Avent and the conundrum that Elliot Avent is. Like, he is a diehard NC State guy. He has been here forever. He is, you know, literally built this program. But at the same time, the guy hasn't won a thing. Like, he hasn't won a title. Like, they've made some runs, some places. They've been to the World Series. I get it. But if you're, I mean, no other coach would get away with 26 years and no hardware, right? I mean, that's what it comes down to. And I think it's a polarizing conversation because I can see, you know, both sides of it where people are going to say, well, the administration hasn't prioritized baseball and he's been dealing with, you know, without the resources he needs to compete and they're still, you know, being competitive. I get that. But at the same time, the other side is like, he hasn't won anything. Like, you're keeping a guy around for a 26th year, 27th year, whatever it is, who has not won, you know, in even a conference tournament.
Yeah.
It's an interesting debate. And I think either way, it's Avent's time, Avent's decision on when he steps down, right? Or when he retires. I don't think you're going out there and forcing him out or firing him. You know, maybe there's a conversation that Boo has with him and, you know, kindly suggests he move on. I don't know how that works. Where do you stand on Avent and his tenure?
So I am a huge Avent critic, but, you know, I'm a huge critic of, I will be fair, I'm a huge critic of, you know, when I'm passionate about something and
sure,
I see things that I don't agree with, you know, I'm going to say what I say. It's obvious he loves his players and his players love him. You said that he built NC State baseball up, you know, he did from his time here. And what all they've gone through. Yes, I agree that the administration has not provided him with everything he's needed. There's been lots of rumors, rumblings about people wanting to donate strictly to baseball, that not happening. You know, the athletic department saying, no, we're not going to do that. And, you know, so he has been hamstrung in some ways, in my opinion, based on the stories that you hear. But I get split on this. In the moment, I'm like, you know, yeah, let him go. But and when I, you know, let the emotions die down, you know, he has taken us to two College World Series. And last year was lightning in a bottle. 2013 was talent. But at the same time, you know, you look at 2013, and State goes out to Omaha. And then the next year, you still have three first-round draft picks on your team. You have Trey Turner, Carlos Rodon, and Brett Austin, who was a supplemental first-round draft pick. And you don't even make the ACC tournament. You lose the play-in game to Carolina. You know, with three first-round draft picks on your team. So that, you know, it's years like that. It's things like that. It's decisions like what we just spent so much time talking about with why would you start Whitaker instead of Willardson on Sunday? It's things like that that just, you know, drive – that's what drives me. And you've seen in the pod chat where I talk about and heard on here at the podcast about middle and backside hitting.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you saw in the ACC tournament this weekend, when we hit to the middle, when we hit to the backside, not only do we score runs, we hit home runs. Everybody loves home runs. You know, I mean, Tommy White just made backside hitting a national phenomenon on whatever night it was that he hit three backside bombs.
Yeah. You
know, every hitting coach who's worth a damn, in my opinion, was drooling watching that game. You know, was saying, this is how it's done, guys. Let the ball travel. Even if the ball's a foot off the plate on the outside corner, you can still drive it that way. You know, and so it's things where we don't hit backside. I feel like sometimes when we go to our, when our players go to the plate, they don't have a good approach, and that's coaching to me. You know, that's a lack of preparation for your guys of understanding who the pitcher is, what his pitches are, where does he like to throw the ball? Is he going to live on the outside corner and just nibble and nibble and nibble? And are you still going up there trying to pull everything? You're going to get out. You're going to strike out. You're not going to, you know, you're not going to get hits. You're not going to score runs. And that's approach, and that's philosophy to me. And that's one of those places where I'm like, okay, this is not cutting it. But then you hear, you know, his players and they love him, and it's, you know, he has built it up. He's built state up without the facilities of a Clemson, of a Carolina, of a UVA. And he's made state somebody that, you know, people don't really want to play against anymore because of, you know, the reputation that state has. They're a good ball club. You know, the one question that I continue to ask, what you just said, and I've asked it in the pod chat, I can't think of any coach at any level in any sport that has been the coach for 26 years at one place and has never won a championship. That's from little league to middle school to high school to college. I don't know. But, you know, maybe year 27 is the year he gets done, you know. Who knows? But it's I don't know. This is another thing, man. A UNC buddy of mine texted me yesterday or Monday, right about 12:30. He said, dude, whose wife did Avent sleep with? I said, what are you talking about? He said, you know, y'all didn't make the tournament. The street, you get sent home from Omaha last year. And this guy is like a diehard, you know, UNC fan through and through. He and I go back to childhood friends and always talking junk. And he's starting to see, like, you know, the there's just a string of bad luck. There's a string of things going on that are just kind of, you know, all in a tornado of work or something. I don't know. But I don't know what it is. You can't put your finger on it. It's bad calls at some points. It's bad judgment at other times. It's bad luck at, you know, at inopportune times. It's all kind of wrapped into one. So
I always equate that kind of stuff to leadership, right? I've said it before. And what's the quote? Preparation, something about preparation helps you win.
Opportunity, right? When hard work meets opportunity. And yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And so that's kind of what, it's leadership at some level, right? Do you consider it the administration leadership? Like, why are we still getting kicked around, mm-hmm. you know, after Omaha last year? That's still one of the, you know, the hottest topics in any baseball conversation. Like, what happened with NC State and Omaha last year? Where was your AD? And, you know, nobody was fighting for you, essentially, right? You know, so is it that, or is it the leadership on the coaching level where, you know, you're just not good enough so that you're reliant on the ball bouncing your way, right? Uh-huh. I don't know where that line is or where you draw that line, but I think it's one of those interesting conversations to me where what's going to happen, I've been adamant all along, I think Avent decides to walk off the minute they break ground on some kind of major renovation to Doak, right? They've talked about it for a long time. It's supposedly happening after this season, but I don't know if that's like the major renovations, like parts of it are coming. You know, it's been so, I guess, poorly communicated that I don't really know, but
from state's athletic department. No way.
Right. Who knew, right? Who would have expected that? But I think at some point that's going to be it. He's going to be like, all right, here's your stadium. This is, you know, my legacy at NC State. And then, you know, here it is, Chris Hart, take over. Right. I think kind of that's how we, that's kind of where we are, in my opinion. I think that's where we're going to go. But what I want to talk about is NC State getting snubbed from the NCAA tournament. It's, you know, they were the, what, 33 in the RPI?
Uh-huh.
Where the baseball committee says, hey, we look at the RPI as one of our, you know, priority metrics. And then the Army AD, Mike Buddy, comes out, and who is the chair of the tournament committee, and says, yeah, they didn't have enough series wins against their league. But literally, State swept ECU, who is the eighth national seed, 17 ACC wins. They beat Miami, another national seed. They made it to the ACC championship game, and they still get left out of the tournament. One of the biggest snubs in tournament history. Has to be. I mean,
in any sport.
Yeah.
In any sport. State went 4-2 against national seeds this year. 4-2 against national seeds.
That's crazy. And I don't know who said it in the chat where we were talking. There's like at some point, or maybe Will said it, like they didn't want to have – they left us out, so they didn't have to talk about us and what happened last year, right? They didn't mm-hmm. want to have that conversation again. It almost feels like that was intentional.
I don't know of a – you know, it goes back to – they tell you these criteria that they're going to depend on, and it goes back to what, 3 years ago with the basketball team, and oh, here's the net rankings. This is what we're going to rely on, and State gets snubbed. And then you hear RPI talk. I mean, like, there was not a single national writer. These guys live and breathe college baseball. That is their job. That is their livelihood. That is their source of income and how they pay the bills. There was not a single national writer who had State not in this tournament. And 95% of them had State as a 2 seed. And so I came home the other day and I was explaining it to Lauren, and I told her, I said, based on how baseball, you know, the region set up and the seedings and the rankings and all this stuff, I said, imagine there's a team, because she pays attention to March Madness, she gets, you know, she understands. I said, imagine there's a team that is a 6 seed. It's supposed to be a 6 seed. Joe Lunardi goes out and said, here's the 6 seed. You know, of what I think. And then the NCAA tournament committee, selection committee says, no, they're not even in. They're not, I mean, a 6 seed. You know, there's, it just, that's the equivalent there. If you do the math and look at it, you know, it's in between a 5 and an 8. So I went with 6. That's the equivalent there. And they're like, no, they're not even in. And it's the Army director, athletic director, who was the chairperson, he went on there and said what he said. But, you know, that's just where you compare apples to oranges just to prove your narrative is correct. You leave out the fact that your number 8 national seed, State swept them this year. Virginia Tech, State went 1-2 against, but State beat Miami too, who's your, what, number 6 national seed. So overall on the year against your national seeds, the top eight teams in the country that you yourself just said, here's the top 8 teams, State went 4-2 against on the year, and you said that they didn't do enough, that they weren't good enough, you know. And I can't sit here and say that it's tied to Omaha. I can't say that it's not, but it feels like in the last 2 years, you know, there's something in the water. There's something fighting against NC State baseball. And the national writers, Stephen Schock, you know, all them, Kendall Rogers, Aaron Fitt, all them are just, you know, they come out and they're tweeting like how, and I think Kendall Rogers wrote a whole piece about it, you know, yeah. For, you know, just saying, how in the world does this happen? How can you justify these things happening? And then to be honest, there is no justification. There is no objective justification for what happened on Monday and State being left out of this NCAA tournament. Objectively speaking, There's no explanation whatsoever. So then that just leaves subjective. And then you're getting emotions and opinions involved. And that's not the way these things are supposed to work. You know, that's not the way it's supposed to boil down. And you think about the seniors from last year's team. You think about the seniors from this year's team. What all they did in the last 2 years to prepare for these moments, and to have one institution, one entity, end both of their seasons in the way that the NCAA just did the last 2 years, man, I would be, I can't say it on the podcast. It would be bad.
That was me. And at some point, I get the conversation where people are going to say, what can Boo do, right? What can he,
Let me, I didn't mean to cut you off. NC State fans are a passionate fan base. Passionate. You know, you can't be an NC State fan and not have passion for NC State after everything that's gone on and everything we've been through. To me, I just want to see some passion come out of the athletic director's office. And a simple tip of the cap and a nod. I mean, I told you, you know, I said in the podcast, in the pod chat, I said, who's going to come out and say, we're disappointed and we think they're wrong. That's it. That's all he's going to say. And that's exactly what he came out and said. And that's no, there's no passion there. There's no teeth. There's no tenacity. There's no, you know, you got, I mean, there's nothing there other than, you know, thank you. May I have another? And that's all it is. It just gets you nowhere. And it doesn't, you know, at least if you, people, some people will say, well, you know, he's not going to go out there and make a fool out of himself. Okay. Well, if he goes out and shows a little passion and does make a fool out of himself, that's just going to endear him more to State fans because of the passion that we all have. You know, I mean, you can't be a State fan. Phillip Rivers said it best. NC, you know, Wolfpack is not for soft. You can't be a State fan and be soft. You can't. After, I mean, just look at the last two baseball seasons and what has happened. Being sent home from Omaha, one win away from the national championship, we were going to win against Vanderbilt. I don't give a damn what anybody says that we were going to the national championship. What would happen against Mississippi State? I don't know, but we were hot, and you see what happens, i.e. Carolina, when teams get hot at the right time. And they get sent home over some bull crap, you know, with all that stuff going on out there, and it's not equitable between teams. It's not that the same rules were not applied to all the teams. And then this year, State does more than enough not to just be a three seed, not to squeak in as a three seed. No, they're supposed to be, all the national writers had them as a two seed. And the NCAA tournament's like, nope, you're not in. But Ole Miss is. Ole Miss is.
Kendall Rogers was talking to somebody else about their College World Series brackets, and he said, I submitted a blank bracket to show off my sincere hate for everyone involved. I'm picking NC State to win my bracket. And yeah, he was furious, just like everybody else, because it is unjust. And I was looking back and just scrolling through, trying to see. I know Boo put out a statement, and turns out it's not on his Twitter. It's on the NC State Athletics Twitter. It says, we are shocked and disappointed that our baseball team did not receive a bid to the NCAA tournament. We hurt for our student athletes and coaches who have worked so hard and who we believe deserve this opportunity, which almost sounds the exact same statement after the bowl game got canceled, yeah, right? And that was – and you said it best. After that game, he came out and he showed a little bit of care about that. He was on camera somewhere and, you know, and said he was frustrated and blah, blah, blah. And everybody's like, all right, you know, Boo, give him a chance. This is better. But then he has a chance here to endear himself and just come out and say, this is unjust. This is not fair. We need to have, you know, just, you don't have to go rage on somebody, but yeah, you know, call your buddy at Army and say, hey, I talked to Mike Buddy, who's, you know, the chair of the committee, and, you know, we want to have some transparency on how this process was done, blah, blah, blah. You know, at least feel like you are trying to do something, because after Omaha, where you were just feckless, and then you come down and it happens again the very next year, it's super frustrating to feel like he doesn't have your back. Right. And as State, absolutely, there are no bandwagon State fans.
No.
Like, if you're a State fan, you've been through this nonsense before. And it just feels like he just doesn't get it, right? He's not, it doesn't feel like he's one of us or has our back in that regards. And that's so frustrating from a fan standpoint.
Exactly. I mean, like what you just said was perfect. Excuse me. If Boo would have come, Boo would have sent out a statement like he does and said, yeah, you know, this hurts. This sucks. I called Mike Bubby, whatever his name is, the Army Athletic Director, who's the chair of the Baseball Selection Committee, and I told him he was flat out wrong. I told him he was wrong. I would have been like, respect.
Yeah.
Appreciate that. Appreciate that. Oh, would you like me to send more money? Okay. You know, but now you're just like, we're hurt. We disagree. Can you fill out this and send more money, please? You know, it's just like, what are we doing here? You know, like you said, the leadership there is not passionate about the wrongdoings that are happening to the programs that they are supposed to care about.
Yeah.
And I don't understand that disconnect there. You know, I don't understand people, you know, NC State's athletic directors, coaches, all of them, you know, they have to go through it as well. But at the same time, a lot of times I feel like NC State fans are taken for granted.
100%. 100%.
You can't name another program in the country at any level whose fans show up the way State fans show up and who endure what we have endured for how many years? 40?
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't happen. It doesn't happen.
And that the last podcast, I went on a bit of a tirade because at some point I got a call that day, one day from the Alumni Association, the Wolfpack Club, and then the Pack of Wolves is sending out messages. They're all asking for money from State fans. At some point, I'm like, where's the ROI on any of this?
Uh-huh.
Right? Who's got our back? Like they want us to donate and contribute, and then people are very fast to say, well, you're not contributing, or you know, State fans are cheap. I was like, man, State fans have been through it for a long time, and yeah. It shouldn't
show up.
Yeah, it's not hard to rally them into some kind of frenzy for the good of the programs, right? Just pretend you have our back, and that's all we're asking. And we just got a nonsense response or non-response, and it's just that part is super frustrating.
Would as a completely objective person, and to take a completely objective viewpoint, if you were donating to the NC State baseball program just in the last 2 years, and you saw what the NCAA had done to them in the last 2 years, would you send more money? I mean, I don't know that you can justify that. I mean, you put the product on the field last year that had just beat Vanderbilt, that was the hottest team in the country, and you send them home at 2:45 a.m. And then this year, they've done more than enough not only to be in the tournament, but to be a 2 seed. And, you know, you don't even give them, you put them in the tournament. So at some point, as a fan, to me, you know, eventually you get to a crossroads where you say, is this worth it? Like what's going on here? They're asking for my money, and I'm giving my money, and we're doing enough on the field, and then we're getting shunned, and this is happening and that's happening. But then, you know, oh, thank you. May I have another next year as well? Please send more money. Wash, rinse, repeat. There's no passion coming out, sticking up for me, giving my money to this program. And that is an issue that I have with that.
Yeah. The whole thing just feels, it's super frustrating to me, and I'm not going to rehash my argument on that. But
Go ahead, Evan.
No, go ahead. I was going to dovetail.
One of the other things is, and I don't know if you saw this, but on this committee that selected all the teams, there's not one single representative from the ACC.
Right. Yeah, I did see that. I saw the people were talking about there's no representation for the ACC. Mm-hmm. And how do you let that happen? How does that happen?
I don't know, because from top to bottom, the ACC is the best conference in baseball this year.
I was going to say, yeah, they're at least one of the deepest conferences.
Yeah, right? from top to bottom. Yeah. Absolutely. It is the best conference in baseball this year. I was texting that same UNC buddy a couple of weeks back. I said, man, the ACC just top to bottom, like they're just chewing each other up and spitting each other out. I said, you know, it's hard to kind of get a pinpoint on where everybody is. I said, it would not surprise me for four ACC teams to make it to Omaha. It would not surprise me one bit. And I don't know, you know, I haven't looked at the full bracket. I don't give a damn right. about a bracket this year after what happened on Monday, you know, but I think the ACC is going to make some noise in the NCAA this year. I don't think, you know, just completely my opinion, I don't think anybody's touching Tennessee with the talent that they have and the year that they're putting together. But it would not surprise me one bit to see, as long as they don't get matched up, as long as ACC teams don't get matched up against each other in super regional play, it wouldn't surprise me to see four teams from the ACC in Omaha. And you know, maybe even five. Wouldn't surprise me at all. You know, but to not have some type of representation on that committee from the best conference in baseball, that's a serious lack of leadership on somebody's part. That's a serious lack of accountability on somebody's part. You know, you think the SEC doesn't have a representative on the football selection committee?
Right. Yeah, right. Exactly.
So that's another.
And that's it. Like, that's, we want, just want a fair shot. That's it. And I want somebody to say, hey, this is not right.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, oh, well, Boo's working in the background. How do I know that?
Yeah.
Right.
I want him to work in the, come up here and work. I want to see it, you know?
Yeah. You know, and that's the thing with state fans too, is that we've had such terrible leadership for such a long time that we're not going to give you the benefit of the doubt. That people are like, well, he's got a good reputation. I don't know that. We had Lee Fowler and Todd Turner as our athletic directors, right? Like,
yeah.
Show me something. Connect with us. Right? Debbie Al wasn't perfect, but she definitely got that part of it.
And absolutely. I think
this is just another opportunity where Boo can connect with us. Instead, he probably put out another video talking to Chancellor Woodson that nobody's going to watch, and you're just
– yeah, it's pointless. I mean, if you look at the last year of state baseball and what all they could have capitalized on, which they have in some way, they've got some donations for the stadium and whatnot. But last year, you know, there should have been emails going out. State got sent home June, 28th from Omaha. There should have been emails going out by July 4th of a place to donate specifically to baseball stadium enhancements. Nothing really happened. Then all of a sudden you hear rumblings of you can donate here at this time and all this stuff. And everything started to fade. And then State put up a decent year, obviously worthy enough of an NCAA tournament bid. But that fire and that, you know, that connection that, I mean, you know, State became, obviously, everybody called them America's team last year when they were in Omaha. And even more so when the NCAA sent them home. You know, when you have another player at the College World Series on a different team hitting a home run in the College World Series, like in the championship round and rounding first base and throwing up the wolf sign, you know, the Mississippi State player rounds first base. And I mean, dude, strike while the iron is hot, you know, and Boo has completely dropped the ball when it comes to NC State baseball. Completely dropped the ball.
It's funny. We're just talking about Debbie Ash. She just put out a tweet on Sunday, May 29th. This is what was projected. Did any writer journalist predict the Wolfpack would be left out? Cannot find one. And she posted the D1 baseball's field of 64 projection.
There was not one.
That's... Why is she doing this, right? Like,
yeah, that's Boo's job. Why isn't Boo tweeting that? Did you see the thing that somebody hacked his account and he supposedly did tweet? Did you see that?
Yeah. So that is hilarious.
What did it say? Like, it said, just woke up, had a dream. I won another AD of the Year award. Where are we headed? You know, talking about the baseball team. Everybody on Twitter was like, the fuck? What are you talking about, man? Yeah,
he claimed it was hacked. That's the new excuse now. Anytime you do something stupid, oh, it wasn't me. I was hacked.
Right.
Yeah, we'll see about that. And the other one I wanted to talk about, we get snubbed. Not only are we a good team, but we have one of the most exciting players in college baseball, a name that everybody knows, Tommy White. And as of the last 2 days, the Tommy White transfer rumors are flying. Mm-hmm. Tommy White, you know, he's homesick. Tommy White's mad he didn't get to play third base. Tommy White, you know, I don't know what to think at this point. I know it started out as a rumor and there was no, you know, there was nothing to it. And even the NIL guys that we talked to, Hayes, Lancaster, Pack of Wolves, said that, you know, Tommy White turned down their deal because his agent said he gets enough national deals. Uh-huh. To me, we talked about earlier that they're offering Tommy White money, a non-exclusive deal, so he doesn't have to turn down anybody else. He can still take other deals. All he had to do was tweet about the Pack of Wolves, and he turns it down. It's a bad sign to me, man. Yeah.
Red flag.
Yeah, red flag for sure. I don't know what is going to happen to this fan base if Tommy White transfers.
To me, like,
it would be a terrible move, too, I think.
The only way I can justify him transferring would be if he is to transfer to a JUCO, which would allow him to go into the MLB draft a year earlier. He has – it doesn't make sense in my mind for him. I mean, you know, okay, maybe he's homesick. Well, let's just do what Carolina does. Okay, all of our really good players, let's buy their mommy and daddy houses and give their mommy jobs at the dental school or whatever. Let's just do what they do so his parents can come move up here with us. Let's just do what, you know.
Seriously.
Seriously. I'm not joking, you know.
Yeah.
Why not? And it's – I can't – it doesn't make sense in my head for him to transfer to another four-year institution, play for two more years when he has created the brand that he has created at State, the following that he has created. It didn't seem like to me after the Pitt game on Saturday night, they interviewed Tommy and Avent, the ACC broadcast did, or whatever channel it was on. And it didn't seem to me that there was any bad blood between Avent and Tommy. So, you know, people talking about, oh, Tommy's mad because he didn't get to play third base or whatever, you know, this, that, or the other. That's all just speculation at this point. And it doesn't make sense. But again, as a State fan, you've come to just expect things to happen that don't make any sense. So, you know, I've heard the rumors are that Florida State's after him hard, you know, which – if you transfer from State to Florida State, who not only is in your conference but is in your division and who you're fighting up against for, you know, a division title every year, if that was to happen, he's going to have some bruises walking out of Doak next year when they come to visit.
Yeah,
you know, he'd be getting ear hole.
I talked to a former player who wanted to remain nameless, but I asked him about the situation. And he said, career-wise, he has nothing to gain by ripping up another league. Only downside, it's only a downside if he backslides a bit. He's king of the ACC if he sticks around. And then I asked him about, you know, what about going to JUCO? He said, it's not a good move. He hits 15 bombs and bats 295, and his draft stock plummets because you have the production you have to put up at that level would be, you know, astronomical. And he said, homesick is the only thing that makes any sense, even though that's the dumbest reason. Guy's going to be a top round pick and spend 15 years traveling around the country playing baseball, not anywhere near his home. So the whole thing sounds ridiculous to me. Like,
I agree with you.
Yeah. There's more to the story somewhere.
Yeah, and I don't disagree with whoever the former player is. You know, he brought up some good points there about if he does go JUCO and does backslide, let's say he gets injured and, you know, his swing isn't what it was this year, or messes up his timing, whatever it is, and, you know, he doesn't put up the number. He would be expected to put up better numbers at JUCO versus what he just did this year. You know, nobody who understands the game of baseball is expecting him to come back next year and put up 27 home runs again.
Right.
It's not going to happen. I'm sorry, State fans. It's not. You know, if he hits 15 next year, that's a good year, because he's going to get walked and they're going to junk ball him to death. And it's
who's going to pitch to him, right? Yeah, well, you'd be getting a moron.
Yeah, and I mean, and I don't mean just junk ball. They're going to junk ball him, you know, 2 feet off the plate, trying to get him to chase, unless he's protected by, you know, people, by somebody who's a good hitter in front of him and a good hitter behind him. Right. And so if he thinks he gets a lot of intentional walks now, go to JUCO, you know. And then, again, on the, going further down that point, if he transfers to a SEC school or – you know, a bigger name baseball school where the lights are even more magnified on him, and he only hits 18 home runs next year. You know, most people, that's a good year, but his perception is going to take a hit there. You know, or it might not be a huge hit, but it's going to take a hit. I agree with you. It doesn't make sense. He's 18. I get the homesick thing, especially, you know, if he's been around his home, you know, all his life. I know he went to IMG, but you know, that's something that just, it'll pass with time. And so being homesick as an 18-year-old is a lot different than being homesick as a, you know, 27-year-old ball player or whatever, making millions. You know, you can wipe your tears with your millions, but you know, I agree with you. It doesn't make sense. For the only thing that makes sense is if he is, which obviously he's a confident guy, which he should be. And it doesn't make sense for him to do anything other than transfer to a JUCO, believing that he can put up equal or better numbers at that JUCO and then go pro after next year. Which, you know, even if he has a backslide, he's still going to go in the top 3 or 4 rounds just because of his age and his what he's done this year. You know, he'll still go high in a draft. But other than that, it doesn't add up. Doesn't make sense.
Yeah, it doesn't make sense that he would also, the other part of it is he's frustrated, didn't get to play in the field. They put him in the field, plays third base, and gets hurt. Like, you know, straight away. Yeah. So, I don't know, man. To me, the whole situation stinks. I'm not going to say Florida State is tampering, but I wouldn't be surprised if they're offering, if they offer him 7 figures or something. You know, don't. And State's not going to say, it's not going to do that, right? We're not going to have that. We're not going to put that kind of money out there. But the fact that he turned down our NIL, to me, when I was told that yesterday, I kind of raised an eyebrow. I was like, huh, that's kind of strange. Why would you turn down basically free money for putting out some tweets?
Maybe he is just such an upstanding young man that he went to our NIL and said, I'd rather you give it to this guy.
I mean, like, I hope that. So. I would love I would love to I'd be
rather,
wrong there.
I'd rather you give it to Josh Hood so that he can come back next year and still hit behind me and hit grand slams when the number 8 national seed decides to intentionally walk me.
Right.
And beat their ass for the second time. Talking to you, ECU fans. You know. And so who knows? You know, it's all speculation. I hope he doesn't leave because of State fans love him. You know, like, I hope he feels that.
Absolute king of the ACC if he sticks around here next year. If he goes anywhere else, the conversation is not going to be how good he is. Conversation is going to be like, he left NC State to go to Florida State. Like, that's, and, you know, the conversation around it is going to be different. And yeah, I mean, to me, I don't know. Sorry. Yeah, no, I mean, I don't know where I'm going.
Well, he captivated everybody. I'd be sitting here watching games on TV at night, and Lauren would go, "When's that guy hitting? When's that guy hit?" You know, I mean, she was paying, you know, she's paying attention to it because of what he just did this year, and it was truly a remarkable thing. He set records, you know, and that's something that that's a once in a generation type season.
Yeah,
that he just had.
It makes me wonder what the turmoil is around the program, where we haven't heard anything from anybody on the baseball team at this point. Not just around him, but around the snub, around the championship game, just nothing. Like, there's been no communication. So it makes me wonder what's going on that there's all the stuff that's up in the air at the moment. Like, and what else is up in the air?
I don't know. I don't follow like current players on any, you know, current baseball, football. I don't do that. But I saw where somebody retweeted something, I think that Whitaker put out today about feeling slighted, or something like that. But, you know, Avent hasn't said anything. You know, you haven't heard anything coming from any players, or I haven't. You know, on any of the message boards or on any of the social media stuff regarding anything, really. You know, it's been radio static and just nothing. And so I don't know if they all got together and decided, let's take a couple of days, decompress, everybody stay off of this, you know, let's think about these things and then regroup, come back together and regroup and see how we want to go about it. You know, but there's been nothing other than former players tweeting out some things here and there with stuff.
You know, it's interesting that I'm curious what the clubhouse dynamic is with a guy like Tommy White, who takes all of the limelight away from anybody else. Not that there really anybody else who deserves it at this point. I mean, we have some good players, whatever, but you know, you have a true star in the dugout. Like, is there any animosity towards him? Like, I don't know if you've been in that situation when in your playing days. Like, I'm curious how that impacts, you know, the situation.
I don't think in the era of NIL,
yeah,
you know, there's no telling with the amount of stuff that he's getting, but it sounds like when he gets stuff, he gives it to his teammates. Mm-hmm. That's the what I've been hearing from multiple people is that when he gets stuff, he gives it to his teammates. And, you know, on the flip side of that, it's like if he's not playing your position, you don't really care because he's part of your team and he's making you win. You know, if there was a senior third baseman on the team who came in and or who was here, and then Tommy White comes in and takes his spot and puts up 27 bombs, then yeah, you might be a little upset about that and the amount of money he's got and the amount of merchandise he's got rolling in and all of that. But other than that, you know, I mean, I don't see it. So
yeah, it'll be interesting to see how this all plays out over the next, I don't know, a couple weeks. I got a feeling we're going to be having another baseball podcast here soon when the dust settles around here, because it's, it's going to be interesting. But I don't know. You got anything else you want to talk about?
I think that's it. I think that covers everything for me for tonight.
It's been, I know we've talked about it quite a bit, but the baseball conversation, the pod chat, has grown tremendously over the last few years. It's wild to see, you know, this many people, you know, just engaging around baseball. I think baseball, college baseball in general, has really grown. And, you know, state baseball, thanks to Tommy White, has really gotten, you know, a lot of people excited. So I would really hate to see him leave. Yeah,
I agree. You know, there's people in the pod chat, you know, they're asking questions and it's fun to talk about these things and then to see, you know, when you're discussing with other people, well, I think this would work, I think that would work, and then to see it actually work. And you know, it's like me in the middle backside. I go ape over that, man. I love it. It gives you see the results. You know, you see the results. And last year with the run that they had helped grow it for state fans. This year with Tommy helped grow it again with state fans. It's continuing to grow, you know, and so it's a good thing overall for the program. But we're not capitalizing on it the way that we should.
Yeah, I agree. Well, Zach, thanks as always for your baseball knowledge on the pod and in the chat. We've learned a lot over the year. And I think we will be talking more baseball here soon, even though the season is over unfortunately, yeah. soon. Yeah.
Yeah, sounds good, man. Just let me know, and then we got football coming up. Hopefully. I'm just in my mind, I'm like, how can the NCAA? And that's another thing. Hey, man, you know, maybe Boo doesn't want to say anything. He's chair of the football playoff committee this year. Maybe, you know, he's not trying to rock that boat.
You know, I've somebody else had mentioned that too. Like, he's not wasting his, I don't know, what's the right word?
Chips. Like, he's not playing his chips yet.
Yeah, know? Right. He's not wasting his bullets on, you know, a dead baseball season. He's saving it for some sort of, who knows what could happen, like trying to put us in the playoff. I don't know what the.
He's saving it for getting us in the playoff, for having to convince everybody that we're playoff worthy after we're 13-0, after Devin Leary throws for 5,000 yards to get him the Heisman, and for Ant Smith to be ACC Rookie of the Year after he catches 20 touchdowns.
Let's go, Ant Smith.
I'm talking to the pod chat right there.
We might have some bets going on Ant Smith's production and going on in the chat. So, yeah, I can't wait. I'm in on it. Let's go, Ant Smith. But as always, Zach, thanks for joining. Thanks for listening, y'all. So support the pod. And talk to y'all next time. Go Pack.
Go Pack. I was raised by the wolves, 874.